God Says Yes to Me by Kaylin Haught. I asked God if it was okay to be melodramatic, and she said yes. I asked her if it was okay to be short, and she said it sure is. I asked her if I could wear nail polish or not wear nail polish, and she said, honey, she calls me that sometimes. She said, you can do just exactly what you want. Thanks, God, I said. And is it even okay if I don't paragraph my letters? Sweet cakes, God said. Who knows where she picked that up? What I'm telling you is yes, yes, yes. Won't you pray with me? Holy One, may it be well with our souls. May we hear your yes to all of these our questions. Are we enough? Are we enough? Holy One, speak through me, and may all of our meditations be delectable in your sight. Amen. 2 weeks ago, we started our Lenten journey with Ash Wednesday, which is honestly one of my favorite holidays of the church year. With an ash cross drawn on our foreheads using burnt palms from the Palm Sunday the year before, each of us is reminded that we come from dust and will return to dust. Ash Wednesday is a day for vulnerability and gratitude. It is a sacred reminder that we are held in the palm of God's hand. This year was particularly interesting because Ash Wednesday also fell on Valentine's Day. So Zach came by with flowers and chocolate, and in exchange, I put ash on his head and reminded him of his death. It's hard being a pastor's spouse. In truth, I like the juxtaposition of Ash Wednesday and Valentine's Day because if Ash Wednesday asks the question, what will you do with this precious gift of a life? Valentine's Day answers, love and be loved. We are just dust, but gosh, are we lovely. From dust we have come. The second chapter of the book of Genesis contains a folk tale about the creation of the world. And in it, it says that God shapes the first person out of the dust and dirt of the earth. And the name of this first person is Adam, Adam, literally son of clay, or even more literally, dirt man. But the dirt does not come to life until God breathes into it. Adam, son of clay, bears the very breath of God. All over his clay body are the fingerprints of the divine. And I wonder if God got some clay under their fingernails too. I wonder if God was changed. After all, it's hard to love something without being changed by it. And why would God miss out on this particular kind of magic? We are bound to God with a profound, indwelling, intertwined love. In the Gospel of John, Jesus says, I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. We are connected in ways that we can't fully grasp. As the monk Thomas Keating once put it, the notion that God is absent is the fundamental illusion of the human condition. But sometimes, in small flashes or life-shaking moments of clarity, we become aware of just how deeply we are intertwined. Every so often, the scales fall from our eyes and we stare in wonder. I think that one of these moments is recorded in today's psalm. It's such a beautiful psalm. It's sort of the kind of thing that you hate to preach on because it preaches itself. The poet says, if I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths of Sheol, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn and settle on the far side of the sea, even there, your right hand will guide me. Your hand will hold me fast. We began our Lenten exploration of prayer with a reminder that prayer is communal last week. We talked about how being Christian is to be in community. And yet, prayer is also a deeply personal connection to our Creator. It is a relationship that we are rooted in with our God. The psalmist says that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. But because I can't let any Hebrew lay there, I have to translate it again. A better translation of fearfully is actually reverently, with awe and amazement. Beloved, you are reverently made. So when we gather in worship, in reverence to the holy, we enter the very spirit into which we were born. We tap into the deep connection to the transcendent that sparked all of creation. How might your relationship with yourself change if you truly believed that God made you in a spirit of worship? I think that it is often easier for us to admire other works of creation, especially things in nature. It's easier for us to look at them and say, "Can you believe God made that?" But beloved, the hands that made the forests and the oceans and the stars knit you together piece by piece by piece. And in the same way that we are called to care for creation, we are also called to acts of self-love and self-care. Every time we attend therapy or take our medication, whenever we nourish our bodies with food or sleep, we are engaging in acts of stewardship and gratitude. What if all we truly have to do in this life is learn to love ourselves well? Because if we start there, so much becomes possible. We are strengthened by the solid ground beneath us, by the roots planted in the knowledge of our own belovedness, and justice and generosity become more sustainable as the love flows from our hearts out into the world. We start here. So the psalmist says that we are reverently and wonderfully made, but I think the word wonderfully could also use a rewrite. The Hebrew word here means to be distinct, set apart, unique. So you could say that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, but you could also say that we are reverently and uniquely made. Imagine God's delight as they formed each person and saw how unique we are. No two the same. At the beginning of worship each week, we affirm our welcome to people of every size, ability, and gender expression. And we don't just say this because it seems like a nice thing to say, or even because we know that we're supposed to. It is far more foundational than that. In celebrating the diversity of creation and fostering it in this, our community, we celebrate the incredible creative power of our God. The ways that in each unique person, God is revealing God's self to us, piece by piece by piece. This is the root of social justice from a Christian perspective. We defend the right of each person to live a life full of joy and dignity because we know that in the fullness of God's creation is the fullness of God's delight. Because we know that they were reverently and uniquely made, and who are we to disagree? Who are we to forsake what God calls holy, holy, holy? Today we celebrate Gwen's baptism, and we bear witness to her belovedness. Baptism is another way that we as a community remember that we are all reverently and uniquely made. The baptismal waters reflect our faces, the faces of our community, and remind us whose we are. In honoring Gwen, in affirming that she is a beloved child of God, we remember that God looks at each of us and says, "Wow, aren't you lovely?" Won't the beloved of God say amen?